So a patient walks into your office and they have a lot of tooth pain. What can you do to accurately diagnose their condition and form a treatment plan that makes sense? Hey, what is up guys? It's Dr. Sammy, and in today's video, I'm gonna talk about how I accurately diagnose tooth pain and some of the tests I do to help me make those really important decisions. So in dentistry, we see a lot of patients that are in pain, and sometimes it's really hard to pinpoint what is causing that pain and how to treat our patients most effectively. So I wanna talk about all the things that I do when I see a patient who's in pain. So the first thing that I'm gonna do is ask really important questions. And I do this before taking any imaging, before taking pocket depths, and all the other things that we're gonna talk about towards the end of the video. So a patient questionnaire is incredibly important, and it gives me a lot of information that I can use to make better informed decisions. Like, what is the severity of the pain from 1 to 10? Like, when did this pain occur? When did this happen? Were you chewing on something? And a bunch of other questions that allows me to understand exactly what is going on with our patients. The more time you take on this step, the more informed you're gonna be. And a lot of the times, like 80% of the time, I'll already know exactly what's going on with the tooth because I asked really relevant questions. I'll try to put my most commonly asked questions somewhere over here. The next thing that I do, or my dental assistant does, is to take imaging. I typically want a periapical image and I want a bite wing image. And these images tell me different things. The periapical image gets the entirety of the root of the tooth and allows me to see whether there's an infection in close proximity to the apices of the tooth. It also allows me to see if there's any crack line on the root. Now, because this is a two-dimensional image, sometimes it's very difficult to see crack lines, but sometimes you can actually see horizontal fracture lines close to the apex of the tooth, and this gives me a lot of information. And also with a periapical image, sometimes you can see what's going on with the periodontium around the tooth. You can see whether there's any vertical bone defect or a horizontal bone defect, or if there's anything else going on with the bone around the tooth. The bite wing image is also really, really important. A bite wing image, because of the orientation of how the x-ray passes through the tooth and goes to the sensor, is a more accurate representation of the tooth. So if we're looking at any cavities, we get a better idea of the extent of the cavity, of how large it is, if it's in close proximity to the pulp, or if the tooth is chipped in any way. So by looking at the PA and the bite wing, and also asking the questionnaire, now you can already tell that we're starting to get more and more of the story. The next thing that I like to do is take accurate probing depths. So it's really important to get that perioprobe out and to probe around the tooth, circumferentially around the tooth, to see if there's any isolated deep pocket. Of course, we are looking for numbers that are small, like 2s and 3s, but sometimes when we're doing these pocket measurements, you'll find an isolated deep pocket of 7, 8, 9 millimeters. And when you have that deep pocket, as we know, we're thinking that the tooth possibly has a deep crack in it, and whether the tooth has to be extracted, and putting that in our treatment possibilities. And a quick word on probing depth. Sometimes it's uncomfortable as doctors to do pocket measurements accurately because we notice that our patients are in a lot of pain. So sometimes it's better if you delay this step towards the end of the treatment when you do all the other testing that we're gonna talk about, and you can get the patient a little bit numbed up so that you can accurately give those measurements without hurting your patient. So that's just something that I wanted to put out there. Okay, so what are some other tests that we can do? Well, if we're considering endodontic therapy, then we have to consider the typical testing: palpation, percussion, and cold testing. And that's gonna give you an idea of the pulpa diagnosis and the periradicular diagnosis of the tooth. So as you guys know, percussion testing is when you tap on the tooth with the back end of a hand mirror, or if you have another device that you wanna tap on the tooth with. And typically the way I do it is I start by testing a tooth that I don't expect to be the one causing the problem. And I use that as a baseline measurement. I look at their response. And if someone is percussion positive or it's very tender when you're tapping, then there's a possibility that the tooth needs to be root canal treated. Of course, there are other possibilities as well, like a high occlusion, or if our patient had a previous filling that was high, that was done recently, and that's why it's important to have a really good questionnaire. But percussion testing is really important. Palpation testing is basically when you kind of feel around the vestibule, around the apices of the teeth that you are concerned about. And sometimes you'll notice a little bit of swelling with touch, so make sure that you do a palpation test as well. And I don't want to bore you guys with the details, but cold testing is when you take a cotton pellet, and you can take cotton pliers, you put a cold material on it, you put it on the tooth. And if you're getting a normal response, sometimes people will experience a little bit of sensitivity, and that's fine. But sometimes you put it on the tooth and whoa, you just basically jump out of the chair. And you get this delayed response, and it's really sensitive. And that allows our endodontist to formulate a palpal diagnosis and to figure out what to do with the tooth. So don't forget about those endodontic tests as well, so that you can give an accurate diagnosis to your patient and hopefully give the best treatment plan possible. Okay, so let's say you do all of that and you still don't know what the heck is going on. Well, let's think about the ones that aren't really used often. So one of the things that's really hard to diagnose in dentistry is going to be cracked teeth. And one of the ways you can test to see if a tooth is cracked is, of course, through visual inspection, but you can also take a cotton roll, have your patient bite down on the tooth that we suspect to be a problem, bite down hard and release. And upon the release, if they're experiencing pain, then there might be a possibility that the tooth has a crack in it. Cracks are really difficult to diagnose. And honestly, the best thing that you can have are loops with really powerful magnification, a really good illuminating source to allow you to visualize a crack. There are other tools on the market as well, but you wanna be able to see where the crack extends to, and then you're gonna have to decide whether to do a filling or a crown. And sometimes you still don't really know whether that's going to resolve their problems. And I don't really want to dive into too much about cracked teeth right now, because that's a monster topic in itself. So if you guys want to hear more about cracked teeth, leave it down in the comment section below, and I'll tell you what I do for cracked teeth or how I approach it in my practice. You know, sometimes our patients have generalized pain all throughout the mouth. And when you have generalized pain, typically what I'm thinking is something related to their habits, their at-home habits. So automatically what comes into mind for me is what's in their diet. Are they eating something super acidic? What type of toothpaste are they using? Did they switch toothpaste recently? And if they tell me that they're using a charcoal toothpaste, or they're telling me they're using something abrasive, then I know that that sensitivity is most likely related to the toothpaste that they're using. And sometimes I will give them a prescription-based toothpaste like Prevident, or I will recommend Sensodyne Rapid Relief, and I wanna see if their symptoms resolve. Another big thing that you have to think about is whether your patients are clenching or grinding their teeth. And you know, our teeth are constantly shifting and moving throughout our life, especially if you have a lot of spaces in your teeth and you don't have a stable occlusion, then your teeth are definitely shifting. And sometimes a tooth can shift in a way that when you bite down, you're putting all those forces on one tooth, and that pain is typically caused by a high occlusion. So when I can't really rule out everything, I don't jump to root canal or whatever aggressive treatment is out there, or crowning teeth or whatever. Typically what I like to do is adjust the occlusion if I don't suspect anything else. And then I want to see how the patient does after a week. And sometimes a simple adjustment in occlusion is enough to make them feel really comfortable. Of course, there are appliances out there that will help people that are clenching or grinding their teeth, like an occlusal night guard that you wear at night. And that's something I definitely recommend, because I'm seeing so many cracked teeth nowadays, especially with the stress related to, you know, coronavirus, people losing their jobs and whatever. I'm noticing a lot of cracked, broken teeth. So wearing a guard is one of the best things you can do if you're having clenching or grinding related issues, to prevent your teeth from banging into each other when you sleep 6 to 8 hours at night. So that's another preventative measure that I like to recommend if I expect grinding or clenching or whatever. And of course, you can look at the teeth, and they're gonna give you an idea by looking at the wear patterns on the teeth. And I took a course at Spear Education that talked about that. I'll put it down in the link below if you guys are interested in that. So that's kind of my list. I'm probably missing things here and there, and if you guys have any other recommendations, put it down in the comment section below. But I want to go back to the first thing that I talked about, which is one of the biggest items, which is communicating with your patients, asking questions, asking follow-up questions. When you're doing these diagnoses, don't just run through it. Like, really talk to your patients, really work out what it is they're feeling, because feeling is subjective, and we have to really make sure that we're communicating well with our patients so that we understand their condition and we make the right decision. So what do you guys think? Am I on point with my recommendations, with my diagnosis? Is there anything else that you would add? Let me know, leave a like. It really helps the YouTube algorithm promote this channel, and I will definitely see you for the next one. Thank you.